Я бы хотел поприветствовать его превосходительство генерального секретаря Антонио Гутерреша, которому я предоставляю слово.
Thank you, Mr. President, Excellencies. I thank you for this opportunity to brief you on women, peace and security 20 years after the landmark Security Council Resolution 1325. The COVID-19 pandemic is the greatest test the international community has faced since the Second World War. And in March, I appealed for an immediate global ceasefire so that we could focus on our common enemy, the COVID-19 virus. I built on this call in my address to the General Assembly last month. And in your resolution supporting a global ceasefire, this Council made a strong and valuable link to the Women, Peace and Security agenda. First, you said the pandemic will have a disproportionate negative impact on women and girls. This is proving to be true both in conflict zones and around the world. Women are already suffering from rising gender-based violence. There are clear signs that resources are being diverted from women's health, including sexual and reproductive health. The pandemic could have a long-term impact on girls' participation in education and on women's employment. This will contribute to the continued marginalization of women from political decision-making and peace processes, which damages everyone. Second, you noted that women are playing a crucial role in the response to the pandemic. Women at all levels are on the front lines of the COVID-19 response, dominating sectors of the economy that are critical to daily life. Women caregivers, nurses, teachers, farmers, food sellers, and other essential workers are providing the services that keep communities, economies, and societies running. We must recognize these women as the peace builders they are at the local level in communities around the world. We must also recognize women who step up every day in conflict zones to help those at risk, mediating between groups to enable access by civilians and humanitarian aid, building trust and strengthening social bonds. Third, your resolution called for women to be in position of leadership and decision-making everywhere. We have seen the remarkable success that many women leaders have had in containing the pandemic while supporting people's livelihoods. This confirms an obvious truth. Institutions, organizations, companies, and yes, governments work better when they include half of society rather than ignoring it. Women's leadership and decision-making is not a favor to women. It is essential to peace and progress for all. We cannot hope to turn the climate crisis around, reduce social divisions, or make sustained peace without the full contributions of all of society. Women's leadership in all spheres will be critical to finding the fastest, safest route through the pandemic and to building a more peaceful and stable future. Monsieur le Président, 20 ans après l'adoption de la résolution 1325, nous avons vu des changements importants dans la façon dont l'Organisation des Nations Unies traite les enjeux de paix et de sécurité internationale, dans les ressources que nous investissons et l'expertise que nous déployons. Le mouvement en faveur des droits des femmes et des soutiens au sein des gouvernements et des institutions internationales ont permis de modifier des lois discriminatoires, franchir des étapes importantes dans la représentation politique et la jurisprudence internationale et faire bouger les choses dans les processus de paix. Toutefois, l'égalité des genres est premièrement et avant tout une question de pouvoir et où que nous regardions, ce sont les hommes qui dominent les instances de pouvoir. Les femmes ne dirigent que 7% des pays du monde. Les hommes représentent les trois quarts des membres des équipes et des comités chargés de lutter contre le COVID-19 et les décisions concernant la paix et la sécurité internationale continuent d'être prises à une écrasante majorité par des hommes. Même si les femmes sont de mieux en mieux représentées dans les équipes de médiation de l'ONU, elles demeurent largement exclues des pourparlers et des négociations de paix. Prenons quelques exemples récents. Les femmes sont-elles équitablement représentées dans les discussions sur le futur de l'Afghanistan menées entre les talibans et le gouvernement? Ou au Mali, pays qui amorce une transition politique? Le Soudan est-il en passe de satisfaire au quota de 40% des femmes députées comme énoncé dans la déclaration constitutionnelle? Le Soudan du Sud atteindra-t-il le quota de 35% des femmes préconisé dans la branche exécutive du pouvoir par l'accord révitalisé sur le règlement du conflit? Au Yémen, trouve-t-on des femmes à la table des négociations parmi les protagonistes politiques et les partis au conflit? Si la réponse à ces questions est non, alors qu'il est évident que la tâche devant nous se heurte à de sérieux obstacles. Prenons la participation significative et efficace des femmes à la médiation. Cette participation élargit les perspectives de paix, de stabilité, de cohésion sociale et de progrès économique. Mais s'assurer que les femmes prennent pleinement part au processus de paix exige aussi de renforcer les partenariats entre l'Organisation des Nations Unies, les organisations régionales, les États membres et la société civile. Nous devons utiliser toute la gamme d'outils à notre disposition et trouver des solutions innovantes susceptibles d'avoir un impact rapide et déterminant sur la représentation des femmes. Les mesures temporaires spéciales, telles que les quotas, peuvent faire une énorme différence. J'en ai été moi-même témoin en tant qu'homme politique dans mon propre pays. Il est grand temps que l'Organisation des Nations Unies et les États membres examinent ensemble comment utiliser au mieux notre influence politique, le financement et le soutien dont nous disposons pour encourager et créer les conditions requises pour une représentation et une participation égale des femmes au pourparlers de paix. L'inclusion des femmes dès le départ doit être une priorité. Les processus de paix se déroulent en ligne durant la pandémie. Il importe de ne pas ralentir l'action menée en faveur de la participation des femmes. Mr. President, when I became Secretary General, ending discrimination against women within the United Nations was one of my first priorities. We achieved gender parity in the leadership of the United Nations at the beginning of 2020, with 90 women and 90 men as full-time senior leaders. We also have parity among our resident coordinators, including in countries affected by conflict. In field missions, women's leadership has leapt from 21% to 41% in just 3 years in our special political missions, and 52%, sorry, in 2 years, in just in 3 years. And in our special political missions, 52% of heads or deputy heads of those missions are now women. I'm determined to push for parity at all levels, well ahead of the deadlines. Women's full participation is also relevant for uniformed personnel. I commend this Council for passing the first resolution this year focused on women in peacekeeping. The numbers of women deployed are still too low, but they have increased significantly in the past 5 years. This is important, not just because the United Nations must reflect the people we serve, but because women bring their own perspectives and expertise to every issue, including peace and security. One of the foundational tenets of the Women, Peace and Security agenda is that weapons do not make us safer. This has been proven once again by the COVID-19 pandemic. In 2019, global military expenditure reached $1.9 trillion, following the largest annual increase in a decade. Meanwhile, women in some countries are at greatest physical risk where they should be safest, in their own homes. Their chances of suffering violence may be equivalent to or higher than in a war zone. The COVID-19 pandemic has only increased this threat. The Women, Peace and Security agenda challenges the relentless focus on interstate conflict at the expense of measures to protect women. In the past 20 years, academic research and practice have demonstrated the close links between gender equality, conflict prevention, and peace. The Women, Peace and Security agenda calls for a broader consideration of ways to prevent conflict, prevent gender-based violence, and to create peaceful, inclusive communities and societies. As we recover from the pandemic, we face a choice: to continue down the path of increasing militarization, conflict, and intergenerational losses, or to work towards greater inclusion, equality, and prevention of conflicts and crises of all kinds. For governments and international institutions everywhere, gender equality is one of the surest ways of building social cohesion and trust and inspiring people to be responsible, participating citizens. Mr. President, for the women mediators, peace builders, human rights defenders, and essential workers who risk their lives to build peace, For the millions of women, men, girls and boys whose hopes for peace and security rest on more equal and just societies, we cannot wait another 20 years to implement the Women, Peace and Security agenda. Let's start that work together today, and I thank you.
Я благодарю генерального секретаря за его брифинг. Насколько мы понимаем,